Hare Krishna. Grateful to be here in the Govardhan village. So I've been just outside India for almost 6 months, and all over the world, especially where Western outreach is happening, devotees are very appreciative of the Govardhan village, and it's a model of what we need for bringing Krishna to the world. We want to bring people to Krishna, but we also need to bring Krishna to people. So, for that purpose, it's a wonderful outreach initiative. I'm grateful to be here, and I'll try to serve in some small way. So I'll speak 4 points today, and after each point, I'll have a little pause, and if any of you have any comments or any questions, we can discuss, and then we'll move on. So I'll talk 4 main points. Here, Sati is accusing Shiva of partiality, Daksha of being envious of Shiva, who is actually impartial. Then Prabhupada, then I'll talk about how the quality of the devatas is manifesting from Krishna. So Prabhupada quotes Krishna's quality to reflect this. Samoham Sarvabhutesh. Third point I'll talk is about how Krishna is impartial, and yet he is partial. So how, and last point I'll talk about how this principle of both impartiality and partiality plays out in our lives when we interact with devotees and with Krishna. So this first point, in this pastime, here has come to a very tragic finale, where Sati is soon going to immolate her body, and before that she is expressing her outrage at the behavior of her father. In traditional societies, to speak openly against one's seniors, one's elders, is considered to be extremely inappropriate. And yet, there are times when the situation is such that, and the emotions that arise from the situation are such that one may speak out. So this is such an occasion where Sati is speaking out against her own father. And she's saying that Shiva, he is actually Sarvatma, Samastatma, he is the universal being. Talks about two things, that actually he is equal to everyone, and therefore who can be envious of him? It's no one except you can be envious. Now, why is she saying that you are envious? Because he has refused to offer due respect to Shiva. That there is a big ceremony going on, and in that ceremony, every respectable person, it's a yajna, it's a fire sacrifice, and in the fire sacrifice, each of the devatas is given a portion of the sacrifice. So, Daksha has arranged that there is no portion of the sacrifice given for Shiva. So, if there is a big festival and we invited devotees from across the world, and say there are senior Prabhupada disciples who have come for a big festival, and say all senior devotees are given a seat of honor, a chair to sit, and one particular senior devotee, there's no chair offered. It would be disrespectful. It would be inappropriate. And why would somebody not do like that? So the situation is similar. So why would we not give respect to someone for the respect that is due to them? That is because of envy. So envy means we feel unhappy about that person's position and want to pull that person down. I suppose we can do a service very well. So if we can speak nicely, and somebody else also speaks nicely, and then somebody glorifies that, this is doing such a nice class. And then you say, but do you see how much prasad he eats? Yeah. Now, what are we doing by that? So, instead of appreciating the devotee, you're finding some way to pull the devotee down. That's, what has that got to do with somebody is giving classes? But we may, so when we don't want to give a due respect to a particular person, that indicates the presence of envy over there. And it's interesting, what has happened is that he feels that Shiva did not respect me appropriately. Earlier, when he was hosting a ceremony, Shiva was lost in thought, contemplation in the divine, and when Daksha came in, everybody honored him by getting up. But Shiva was lost in meditation of the Supreme, and that's why he did not get up. And because of that, he got angry. He spoke strongly against Shiva, and he's still holding on to that grudge. And now, he is not given any position. He is not given any position to Shiva. Although Shiva has not been invited, but even if Shiva is not invited, actually the devatas are capable of being present at multiple places. And in the ceremonies, even if the devatas don't physically come, for the sacrifice, a portion has to be allotted to them. And Shiva is no ordinary god, he is. He's Mahadev, he's among the greatest of the gods. So here she's saying that Shiva is so kind, so equal, so compassionate to everyone, but you are envious. And so in general, envy is difficult to detect. The Saman Arthas are easy to detect. Say, lust, anger, these are easy to detect. But envy, how do we detect that? It is generally when somebody else is praised. If we feel unhappy at somebody being praised, that is an indicator that there may be envy in our heart. Now, of course, it's not always that if somebody is praised and we are unhappy. Sometimes that praise may be inaccurate. Sometimes that person may have done something wrong and is based on misinformation. So there are nuancing situations. But in general, to feel unhappy on seeing others' glory is a sign of envy. And the mood of a devotee is actually the opposite. A devotee delights in others' joys. Sometimes we may make jokes at other people's expense. We may laugh at others. That is actually another sign of envy. Where, see, you are so fallen, you are so useless. A devotee doesn't laugh at others. A devotee wants to laugh with others. We want everyone to be happy in Krishna's service and everybody to be cheerful. So when we try to look down at others, or we try to, so there are three things. We pull down others from the position where they are at, or we look down at others, and not only we look down at others, but we look down and make fun of others for where they are. So these are all, broadly speaking, indications of envy. And the symptom of that which Daksha is exhibiting here is, he's trying to pull down Shiva by not giving him the deserved position. So any comments or questions at this point? Yes, ma'am.
Just triggered a question in my mind was, where does exactly envy reside? Does it reside in the mind, intelligence, or the false ego? The second sub-part of the question was that if it resides in the intelligence or the false ego, how can we sense if our critical observation is something motivated out of envy, or is it out of some genuine rational observation?
Oh, good question. So,
is envy situated in the mind, intelligence, or ego? And if it is situated in the intelligence, say, then how do we know whether our critical observation is because of envy? Yeah. Firstly, in general, the contaminations are situated in all three. Krishna talks about this with respect to lust. But the way he uses kama there is a very inclusive way. Because Arjuna's question is, what makes me act against my own best interests? Atha kena prayuktoyam papam charati purusha. So, and Krishna says it is kama. Now, if we consider the forces that make us act against our best interest, it is not only lust. It is anger also, greed also, it is envy also. So the analysis in 3.36 to 43 in the Bhagavad Gita, although the word calm is used, it is used inclusively to refer to all self-destructive desires. And there Krishna says all these three, these are present in Indriyani Manobuddhi Asyadishthanam Ichyate Etair Vimohyatesha Jnanam Avritti Dehinam. So 3.40 says that these self-destructive desires are situated in the mind, intelligence and ego, all three. So it's interesting that few verses later, 3.43, Krishna says that therefore use your intelligence, evam buddhe param buddhva samstabhyatmanam atmanam, that with your intelligence situate yourself in transcendence. So if the intelligence is corrupted, then how can the intelligence elevate us? So the point is that we can say mind, intelligence and ego, or we could say there Krishna talks of senses, mind, intelligence. Not mind, intelligence, ego. But the point here is that these are all, we could say, disputed territories. So like if we consider between India and Pakistan, Kashmir is a disputed territory. So now there are some parts of Kashmir which are fully with the insurgents. They are against the government. And there are some parts of Kashmir which are under the government and which are with the government. So now, if India wants to win over Kashmir, then the part of Kashmir which is with India, that has to be empowered. And the part which is against has to be disempowered. So similarly, our intelligence, there is a part of the intelligence which is contaminated by the anarthas. And there is a part of the intelligence which is not contaminated. So correct. So I write on the Gita every day at GitaDaily.com. So one article I wrote of this theme itself is, corruption of intelligence requires correction by intelligence. So therefore, what we need is a reference point separate from our own intelligence to understand which is the corrupted intelligence and which is the uncorrupted intelligence. And that is scripture. So if what our intelligence says is broadly in harmony with scripture, then we can say that intelligence is the uncorrupted intelligence. But if the intelligence is telling us to do something which is against against scripture or against the purpose of scripture, then it is corrupted intelligence. So with respect to critical mentality, in any service that we do, there are certain standards which are to be met. And if a particular execution or performance is of that service is meeting that standard or not, it is essential to evaluate that to maintain those standards. So pointing that out is not envy. Say for example, I am one of the editors for Back to Godhead magazine, Indian as well as international. So the articles that devotees contribute, they are sent to us, and as a panel we review those articles and we point out the strengths and the limitations. So the purpose is not to criticize the author. The purpose is to evaluate whether that contribution is suitable for getting published in BH. So in this case, if our purpose is clear, that our purpose is not to criticize the person per se. So first, at least in our own minds, we should be able to separate the person from the service or the person from the particular activity that they are doing. And this is a soul. The soul is also a part of Krishna. But the way this soul is covered by a body and mind right now, they may not be suited for this particular service. And they may be, but they will have to improve certain things. So generally, if our interaction with people is only when we are pointing out faults with them, then that will lead towards negativity. So if they do good, and we just don't appreciate that good, and only when they do bad, we criticize that bad, then it is possible that our mentality may not be a mentality of service over there. So it's that we often tend to catch people when they're doing wrong, but we need to catch people when they're doing right. So fault finding may sometimes need to be done, but it has to be done as a obligation, not as a temptation. Not that we delight in finding faults with others. Hey, I caught you now. Not like that, but yes. So in a way that is appreciative of the person if we do it. then it's not envy. Thank you.
So, I'll move on to the next point.
We'll discuss later. One moment. So, the second point I was going to make is that here, it's interesting, when Shiva is being discussed, Prabhupada quotes, Samoham Sarva Bhuteshu Name Dveshyosti Navriya. This is directly Krishna referring to himself and saying that I am non-different, that I am equal to all. So, now there is God and there are the godly people. The devatas manifest godly qualities. And in many ways, in the scripture, in a context that is not for establishing philosophical siddhanta, in a context which is more in terms of either conversation or glorification, not establishing philosophical siddhanta, there are times when the devatas are glorified as if they are the supreme. If you see, Hiranyakashipu, when he is trying to satisfy Brahma in the 7th canto so that he can get benediction, so when Brahma appears, he glorifies him as if he is the supreme, that you are the controller of the three modes of material nature. Now we could say this is simply flattery, that Brahma wants to get something from Hiranyakashipu, that's why he is glorifying him. But then we will see in this 4th canto itself, when Shiva is angry and Brahma goes to pacify Shiva, at that time also Brahma glorifies Shiva as if Shiva is supreme. So the understanding in this is that actually the devatas are not entirely separate from the supreme. And in the Western world now, whenever I do outreach, I stop using the word demigods. Because for people in the mainstream world, the word demigod is not familiar to them. And many times devotees, when they speak this word also, they speak it, demigods. People, I was giving a class, and after that one person came into the Hindu temple, and then one person came and he told me that the way devotees use the word demigod, it's as if it sounds like a demon. Now, so I generally use the word devata itself. Devata, or I simply use the word gods. So, demi is, for purpose of philosophical education, we do want to make it clear that there is a difference between Krishna and the devatas. But at the same time, the word demi seems to be a specific minimization of them. So, the important point is that there is this context when we have to look at the bhed. But there is also a context when we have to look at the abhed. Bhed is the separate. The devatas are separate from Krishna. But the devatas are also representatives of Krishna. And the devatas have been given the position not just of universal administration, but also of receiving worship by Krishna himself. That it is Krishna who has arranged the system of universal administration, where the devatas perform both the functions of governing certain aspects of the universe and of receiving worship. So for somebody who can worship Krishna, then there is no need to worship the devatas. But somebody is worshipping the devatas, it's not a wrong activity to do. It's not an immoral activity to do. It's not a sinful activity to do. Krishna says, yajante sattvika devan. He says those who worship the devatas have to have some foundational amount of goodness by which they can understand that there's some higher authority and we need to worship them. So, when the scriptures are not in the sense of establishing philosophical siddhanta, but in the context of a discussion of glorification, the abhed aspect is often stressed. And when the abhed aspect is stressed, it is explained that, Madhvacharya explains this in his Vishnu Dattva Vinirnaya, that actually the devatas represent Shiva. Represents both, in English you have the word, a proper noun and a common noun. Proper noun refers to a name of a person. And common noun refers to a quality. So for example, sage, it refers to a category of people who are sages. But sage is also the name of a person. In English, sage is the name of many sages a female name, basically. So Shiva can refer to the name of a person, and Shiva can also refer to a quality. So Shiva, when it refers to a quality, it refers to the quality of the divine. In the Vishnu Sahasranam, it is said, Sarva Sharva Shiva Sthanur Bhuta Dev Nidhiravyaya. So one of the names of Vishnu is Shiva. Now you say, what is this? Shiva is a different person. How can you have a name of Vishnu as Shiva? But the point is, Shiva refers to auspiciousness. And Vishnu is supremely auspicious. And that auspiciousness of Vishnu, in terms of connecting with and elevating people who are, you know, living in auspicious situations, who are in the modes of lower modes, tamoguna especially, that vibhuti of Vishnu is manifested through Shiva. So we have to recognize that when a vibhuti is manifested, when a particular opulence of the divine is manifested through a particular person, then that person can act in ways that are extraordinary. And therefore, honoring that extraordinary manifestation, there is the understanding that this person is worshipped as if, or is talked about sometimes as the divine. So, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that Pandavanam aham Dhananjaya. Now, when Krishna tells Arjuna that among the Pandavas I am Arjun, I am Dhananjaya, then Arjun doesn't say, oh Krishna, we two are one, why do you need to speak the Bhagavad Gita? Just shut up now. He doesn't say that. Why? Because he's understanding the context in which something is being said. Now, similarly, when Prabhupada is quoting Krishna's quality to illustrate the point of Shiva's quality, the point here is that Shiva is manifesting a quality here of being equal to everyone because Krishna has that quality. So there is a time when the Bhed aspect, the separate aspect has to be seen, but there are also times when the Abhed aspect has to be seen. And if we emphasize only the Bhed aspect, only that, okay, devatas are separate from Krishna, if we only emphasize that, then we miss out on the complete picture. That actually they are also arranged by Krishna. In the Abrahamic religions, there is the one true God and there are many false gods. False gods means they say that these are people who are claiming to be God but they have no power. And they say the false gods have to be brought down so that the one true God's glory can be established. And that's why they have this idea of bringing down temples and desecrating deities. Because they see they have one true God and all gods are competitors to that one true God. They're all false gods. But our understanding is not like that. That the devatas are not competitors to Krishna. They are actually cooperators with Krishna. And for those who cannot connect with Krishna, they also provide a pathway for people to come to Krishna. So there are times when the Abhed aspect has to be emphasized. And there are, of course, times when the Bhed aspect also has to be emphasized. If somebody starts philosophically oversimplifying things and saying that all gods are one, then you say, yes, there is a difference. That all gods are one, but in a qualified sense, not in an absolute sense. So here, Prabhupada is pointing to this, that the quality of Shiva is coming from the quality of Vishnu and that of Krishna. And that's why he is using a verse describing the quality of Vishnu to describe or to illustrate the quality of Shiva. Any questions or comments till now? Yes, Prabhu. About this point, not the previous point. Yes, it's a good question. So, why does Krishna say avidhi purvakam? When he says that those who worship devata, they are also worshipping me. Yeah, so now if you look at the point of the 7th chapter, it's Krishna is talking about vidhi in a particular sense. If you want to look at the word vidhi, it can have many different meanings. If the 7th chapter is especially talking about surrender to Krishna, and he has talked about, 7.14 he has talked about, those who surrender to me go beyond illusion. Then he talks about those who are, the two extremes he talks about in 7.15 and 7.16, that those who don't surrender to him and those who surrender to him. And in between are the worshippers of the devatas and are the monists. So Krishna is not talking about them as demonic. So when Krishna is talking about vidhi, there he is talking about the supreme vidhi. Just like Krishna says, I come to establish dharma, dharma samsthapanarthaya. But in Krishna says, sarva dharmaan pratyajya maam ekam sharanam braj. So there he is telling, he's not rejecting other dharmas, but he's rejecting those dharmas that stop one for coming to Krishna. Maam ekam sharanam braj. So Arjuna doesn't reject the kshatriya dharma. Arjuna still performs functions as kshatriya. And if you look at the Bhagavad Gita's context itself, immediately after the Bhagavad Gita is spoken, just before Arjuna is about to start fighting a war, at that time, the goddess Kali appears in the sky. And Arjuna gets down from his chariot and offers worship to Kali. And Krishna tells Kali is the goddess of destruction, so satisfy her with your prayers, and then her power will be with you so that you can win the war. So that same Krishna is telling Avidhi Purvakam. He doesn't stop Krishna, that same Krishna doesn't stop Arjuna from worshipping the goddess of destruction. So the point here is not that the devatas are not to be worshipped. The point is that the devatas are not to be seen as competitors to Vishnu. So when the devatas themselves are seen as supreme, then it becomes a problem. So if we look at the tradition, there is no confusion about even Lord Shiva Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Shiva's temple. Isn't it? And he composed Shiva Ashtakam over there. So he glorified Lord Shiva. So we see, oh, Arjuna did tapasya to worship the devata so that he would get weapons from them. So Arjuna was clear that Krishna is the supreme object of worship. And the devatas is going for practical things. So over the centuries, asakale ne hamata yogo nashtya parantapa, over the centuries as the Brahminical culture started going down, the clarity about the supremacy of Vishnu started getting confused. And therefore, the acharyas down the tradition has stressed. So if the devatas are considered to be departmental heads and their worship for specific purposes by those who are at a specific level of piety, then there is nothing wrong with that. But when people start misunderstanding the devatas to be supreme, then that is when it becomes a problem. See, the same Krishna who says that avidhi purvakam, that the worship of the devata is, what is avidhi purvakam? The worship of the devata is not avidhi purvakam. It is saying they are worshipping me indirectly. Yepi anya devata bhakta yajante shraddhayanvita tepi mam eva kaunte yajante avidhi purvakam. So they are worshipping me not according to vidhi. The worship of the devatas is not avidhi purvakam. You clear this difference? There is vidhi. There is Shiva Puran. There are so many scriptures. Telugu Rig Veda is full of worship of Indra and things like that. That's all Shastra. So the worship of the devatas is not avidhi purvakam. There is vidhi for worshipping the devatas. There is scripture which allows us to worship devatas. But when somebody is worshipping the devatas, they are worshipping me only, but they are not worshipping me properly. But they will not come to me because of that. Krishna, the point in the 7th chapter is, how does one go beyond illusion? How does one go beyond illusion? Krishna says that it is by surrendering to me. Somebody says, I am worshipping the devatas. Isn't that also worshipping to worship of Krishna? It is, but it is indirect. It is inappropriate. Vishnu Acharya Thakur gives the example that if a river, if somebody on the top of a mountain or somebody on an inland offers water into the ocean, water into a river. Now that water will go to the ocean, but the person offering the water will not go to the ocean. So similarly, those who worship the devatas, that worship also goes to Krishna ultimately, but the worshipper will not go to Krishna. Why? Because that worshipper has not understood that Krishna is the ultimate destination. And that same theme which Krishna talks in the 7th chapter, it talks in the 9th chapter also. When he says, Yanti Devata Devan, Pitru Yanti Pitruvata, Bhutani Yanti Bhutija, Yanti Madhyajinokrima. The same Krishna who has said that this is Avidhi Purvaka. He also says, Yajante Satvika Devan, 78.4, he says, Sattvaguna, that worship of the devatas is there. So we can't take one statement and absolutize it. So when the principles of pure devotional service has to be established, then definitely we have to talk about the bheda aspect. And as compared to the principle of pure devotional service, the worship of devatas is a contamination. But is everybody ready for pure devotional service? It's not that because somebody can't worship pure devotion, can't practice pure devotional service, that doesn't mean they're demoniac. That doesn't mean they have to be condemned. So there is a place where pure devotional service needs to be established. But there is a place for many things other than pure devotional service also in the Vedic context. And those other things, they are not equal to pure devotional service. That has to be very clear. But they don't have to be demonized. They have to be contextualized properly. And people have to be appreciated where they are. It is, I was talking with Giriraj Maharaj in America. And I asked Maharaj that when Prabhupada would go to the houses of life members. Or houses of people who would become life members. At that time, they all had their own altars and their own demigods and semigods. Semigods is say me God. I am God. So they would have their own all kinds of cornucopia of worship over there. So would Prabhupada speak anything about that? Sisters, I never remember Prabhupada speaking anything about that. Naturally, they would, anybody, any sadhu comes to your home, Prabhupada, they would take the sadhu to the altar. So Prabhupada would just fold his hands and he would move on. And he would speak Krishna conscious philosophy and he would give the Krishna conscious message. And it's not that just because we have recordings of Prabhupada's classes, it's not that Prabhupada sees a goddess in somebody's altar and then Prabhupada will give a class of the goddess is not the supreme. He'll worship Krishna. Prabhupada's classes were based on what people needed to hear. Most of Prabhupada's classes are about you're not the body or the soul and rise to serious spiritual practice. So there is a place definitely. When we are establishing pure devotional service, we do need to talk about the bheda aspect. And then from that perspective, demigod worship is not recommended. But just because something is not recommended for aspiring pure devotees, that doesn't mean it is to be condemned for everyone. So, the third point now. I may not be, what time is the class? Okay. So, the third point I was going to speak on is that is Krishna actually, when Krishna says, Samoham Sarvabhuteshu, that he is equal to everyone. But in the very next line, he says, this is the first half, Samoham Sarvabhuteshu Stina Priya. But then the next half is ye bhajanti tumam bhaktya mai te teshu chapyaham, that all those people who are devoted to me, he doesn't just say that they are special, he says I am in them and they are in me. It's a very intimate state of union which Krishna is talking about. So one theme in the Abrahamic conception of God is that God is fair. God does not play favorites. So yes, we also agree God does not play favorites, but God has favorites. To play favorites means to just arbitrarily or based on personal bias favor somebody. So God does not do that. God is equal to everyone. But God has favorites. Among all the gopi devotees of Krishna, Radharani is his favorite. So he has his favorites. So now, here we have to understand the difference between partiality and reciprocity. Krishna is impartial, no doubt. But that impartiality is not stone-like neutrality. If say this bar is insentient, I pat it on the back, it doesn't feel anything. I punch it, it doesn't feel anything. So if we were talking with someone and we spoke harshly to them, they remain equipoised. If we praise them, they remain equipoised. There's no response at all. We might appreciate how equipoised they are, but how much of a personal relationship can we develop with them? Isn't it? Personal relationship requires reciprocity. So when Krishna, for him, Radharani is the favorite devotee, that is not Krishna's partiality to Radharani. Radharani has the greatest devotion for Krishna. Because she has the greatest devotion for Krishna, actually Krishna has the greatest affection for her. So Krishna, you could say, his his impartiality is not stone-like neutrality, it is personal reciprocity. Personal reciprocity means Krishna is partial to his devotees. As he says in 9.29 CND, that those who devote themselves to me, they are in me, I am in them. Krishna is partial to his devotees. But he opens the doors of devotion for everyone. So in that sense, he is partial, but he is impartially partial. His impartially partial means that he says that I favor my devotees. But then he says, next, there is 9.29, 9.30 to 33, he will say that, everyone can become my devotee and come to me. So it's like, if there is a wealthy person, and that wealthy person gives a lot of charity at a particular place. And other places they give less charity. Maybe they go to a holy dham, they give a lot of charity. But anybody can come there and take charity. They're not stopping, only people of this area can have charity. Anybody can come here and get charity. So Krishna, he is a person. As a person, he has his personality. He has his preferences. But those preferences are not arbitrary. So Krishna reciprocates with everyone the way they surrender to him. So Vamshidhar is a commentator on the Bhagavatam, and he gives a beautiful, the seventh canto starts with the analysis of whether Krishna is equal to everyone. And then he gives Narasimha Dev, he actually kills Hiranyakashipu and he blesses Prahlad. So then we may say, how is Narasimha Dev equal? In fact, the first chapter is 7.1 is the Lord is equal to everyone. But in all the chapters subsequently describe the very different dealing of Narasimha with Hiranyakashipu and Prahlad. But then he says, both Prahlad and Hiranyakashipu got the lap of Narasimha. Therefore, Narasimha is equal to both of them. But because their disposition was different, so what the Lord did to them on the lap was different. So Krishna is not partial, he is reciprocal. And that reciprocity is defining for personality. So he's a person, and he, as a person, he reciprocates with everyone. So any questions or comments about this one? Yes, please.
When we hear the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya and Chaitanya Charitamrita, we hear how Lord Chaitanya gave love of Godhead to millions and millions. And in one sense, like his causeless mercy break through the free will of the jivas. So, but on the other side, we see that ye yatha mam prapadyate tam tadeva bhajamyaham. Unless we endeavor, Lord does not give his mercy. So how do we understand the causeless mercy of the Lord? Is that partial or impartial?
Okay. So is the Lord's causeless mercy partial or impartial? Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave pure love of God to everyone, even if they were willing or not willing. That there is a context to what it is being said over there. See, Lord Chaitanya gave mercy to everyone. Patra, patra na dekhi. Now dekhi sthana sthana. Now he gave mercy. But did everyone receive mercy? There's a difference between the two. He gave mercy to everyone, and yes, wherever he went, people became inundated with love of God. But is it that they stayed like that throughout? The soul always has free will. So, in the presence of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they experienced extraordinary love of God. But was it that they stayed in that intoxicated, divinely intoxicated state of God, state of love of God throughout their lives? Did they all become pure devotees and become liberated? So now, there is, if you look at the historical record, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's tours are talked about not just by his devotee biographers, there are other historical records also. There's definitely a resurgence of bhakti that happened during the medieval times. And Lord Chaitanya is considered a prominent propagator of the resurgence of bhakti. But just one generation later, when when the Kheturi festival was held. So at that time, all the devotees, all the people who had followed the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came. And they came from, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went all over North India, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went all over South India. So is it that from all these people, people came to Kheturi? If they had all become, they all got an experience of love of God. But did they all become committed followers who practiced pure love of God, who lived with pure love of God throughout their lives? Did they necessarily become committed followers of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who espoused pure, who manifested pure love of God? That may or may not have happened. So we prominently see that Kheturi, the devotees who came, where there was Bengal, there was Orissa, and there was the Vrindavan area. And that's what other biographers also talk about. So it's not that everywhere there was the great devotees, by their presence and their purity, and of course the Lord by His presence and purity, can give extraordinary spiritual experiences to people. So it's like, as it is said, He opened the floodgates of love of God so that it could inundate people's hearts. But it is for people to take that and to treasure that. The Chaitanya Charan, we cannot take any one statement from scripture out of the context of the broader scripture. The same Chaitanya Charan also illustrates through the example of Kala Krishna Das. I want to speak of having one moment's interaction. He was with for months and months with Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and still he got deluded. Temporarily, of course, he was redeemed by the Lord's mercy. So our free will is always there, and the Lord does not take away our free will. And the principle of mercy, the principle of causeless mercy, means that the mercy is available without cause. Whether the mercy is accepted or not, that is up to the individual only. So Prabhupada says in a purport that if we are fortunate and intelligent, we get Krishna consciousness. So fortunate means the mercy comes to us, the opportunity comes to us. So causeless mercy is that the opportunity comes to us. Now, the word opportunity can also mean many different things. So we may go out and distribute books. That is also giving an opportunity for Krishna consciousness. But there are some devotees who have charisma, who have purity, who can present things in such a way that people will feel much more inspired to take a book at that time. We may give a class, an exalted devotee may give a class. So in both cases, Krishna's mercy is coming. But in some cases, Krishna's mercy may come with far, far greater potency. And then because of that potency, the possibility of that mercy entering into people's hearts is much, much more. So the purity of the preacher can determine how much the mercy enters into the heart. That's why the purity and potency of the preacher also matters, definitely. But ultimately, whether that mercy stays in the heart or not, that depends on the free will of the person. So the free will is never, there are devotional declarations of glorification of glory of a particular manifestation of the Lord or of the Lord Himself. These are meant to demonstrate the potency of the Lord's mercy. They are not meant to say that the free will itself is removed. The free will is always there. In some situations, when causeless mercy comes, and then the soul changes the free will. In the Bhagavatam itself, I think the Bhagavatam, we can consider the example of Dhruva. He got the darshan of the Lord and he gave up his desire for the kingdom. Pururava, he got the darshan of the Lord and still he desired Urvashi. Darshan of the Lord is mercy, but the result of that is different on different people. The free will is never given up, but the opportunity for getting mercy is what makes the mercy causeless. Okay. So I'll quickly mention the last point and then we'll stop. So I was talking about that Krishna is impartially partial. So similarly, when we live in a devotee community, sometimes we may sense that there is some partiality. that some devotees are favored more, some devotees are not favored so much. And we may feel that, why is this happening? So we have to understand that what we may think of as partiality may simply be reciprocity. Prabhupada said that, once Prabhupada was asked, do you love all your disciples equally? And Prabhupada said, yes. And he added, if somebody comes forward to do service, I reciprocate. I reciprocate. That means that sometimes a senior devotee may give some special attention, special time, special facility for some devotees. But that's simply because that devotee is taking up responsibility. And we see that Prabhupada appointed some devotees to become his successors at that time, in terms of becoming gurus. But then when Prabhupada was asked, who will be your successor, Prabhupada said, also said, whoever wants to be. Prabhupada did not appoint one official successor. And he also did not appoint successors in the sense that he said that these are the only people. He said that those. So now, I was in America, I was talking to Ravindra Swarup Prabhu. So Ravindra Swarup was saying that Prabhupada did not play favorites. He said, at that time, the devotees who were the most dedicated, the devotees who were doing the most service, those are the devotees whom Prabhupada appointed as spiritual masters. So now, those devotees, some of them were able to continue, some of them were not able to continue. It is not Prabhupada's partiality. Prabhupada was reciprocating. And we see those devotees in Prabhupada's movements who have taken up responsibility now, they have become prominent leaders. So it's a matter, sometimes some situation may seem to be such that there is partiality or something like that. But there is a circumstantial and there is a transcendental. Circumstantially, so certain circumstances may favor one person and not favor another person. But we have to understand beyond the circumstantial, there is a transcendental Lord. And the Lord is an observer. If somebody is serving sincerely, even if at a particular time, they are not being favored, they are not getting opportunities to serve, they are not getting opportunities to grow. But the Lord will notice and the Lord will enable them to grow. And we see this in Prabhupada's life himself. Prabhupada, for 40 years of his preaching, he got no success and no facilities. He did not get any, did not have any dedicated disciples, he did not have any institutional support, he did not even have financial resources. There's nothing working for him. But he was serving diligently. And then when Krishna reciprocated in an extraordinary way. So sometimes when we feel that there is partiality in the devotee community, rather than getting hung up on that, we can go beyond that and focus on Krishna's reciprocity. If I am serving Krishna, Krishna will reciprocate. In what way and when, that we may not know. But Krishna observes and Krishna always reciprocates. And that reciprocity is the devotee's ultimate hope for persevering in the practice of bhakti. So you ask any question about this point? Let's stop with that. Yes, last question.
In this present age where social justice and social equality is the most prominent ideology, how can we, one, at our own individual level, learn to accept this mood of reciprocity from individual or an institution? And two, how do we communicate this to the people around us within the institution and outside the institution to understand that, you know, this is how things work?
Okay. So, in ethos of social justice is very important. How do we communicate this principle of reciprocity? Yeah. The idea of social justice is the defining characteristic of the postmodern ethos. It's almost implicitly accepted that all people are equal, or at least they should be treated equally. And it's understood that certain communities were treated unfairly in the past, and they need to be given special treatment. So, in this situation, in general, in the material world, there is the principle of equality. And there is the practice of hierarchy. Both of these are required. We may say everyone is equal. But when road traffic is going on, if the cop pulls you over, the row person driving a car cannot say, your opinion, my opinion equal, I'll keep driving. Isn't it? There is, for functioning in the world, hierarchy is required. So, communism was an attempt to try to create absolute equality. And there was a social critic of communism who said that in communism all people are equal, but some are more equal than others. So those who were ruling, they had so much more privileges. And those who were ruled, they often lived in poverty. So the idea of absolute equality at the material level is an impossibility. We just can't have it. In fact, there's a whole philosophical reasoning by which we can say that our very hankering for equality points to our spirituality. Because implicitly, we believe that everybody should be treated equally. But at a material level, by no parameter at all, will people figure out as equal. Look at their height, look at their weight, look at their IQ, look at their EQ. People are different. So, at a material level, there is no rationale for our intuition about equality. So just our longing for equality can point to something which is beyond the material. And that is our spirituality. So our longing for equality, it points to our spirituality. It's not a conclusive argument, but it is a strong inference that we can make. So in general, wherever people become too religious and too ritualistic, they stress hierarchy over equality. And when people become too spiritual in the sense that the word spiritual, we use it as to mean committed to the practices of spirituality. But people use the word spiritual in the outside world, they say just anything which makes me feel good, that's what they call as spiritual. So when people become too spiritual, then they emphasize equality at the expense of hierarchy. So both are functional requirements. Both are essential. If there is only hierarchy without any understanding of equality, there will be abuse of power. The hierarchy will be absolutized. Like in the caste system that happened here, that was absolutized. The hierarchy alone was considered important. And it led to great abuse. So the same happened. I was in Canada, and in Canada there are the Native Americans. The Canadian government published an official apology to the Native Americans because for generation upon generation they were abused. So only hierarchy, yes, we are the white men and these are the uncivilized lower people. So only hierarchy leads to problems, but only equality also leads to problems. In American education, there was an experiment done, especially in California. California is the area where there is this ethos of equality. But they said that if a student does anything wrong, the teachers should not tell the student that you are wrong. Because you tell a person you are wrong, that will damage their self-esteem. And if a teacher says, oh, a student says 2 plus 3 is 5. Well, that's interesting. How do you figure that out? And the end of that was that they tried this experiment for about a decade. And those kids, when they grow up, they are the socially least adjusted, socially most maladjusted. They can't perform at jobs. They can't compete in the real world. So the idea was the teacher and the student are equal. How will education happen then? So, yes, the student should not be minimized or rejected. The student's intelligence also needs to be respected. But the student's intelligence has to be subordinated to the teacher's intelligence so the student can learn. So both equality and hierarchy are required for functioning in the world. So I think if we give examples practically where authority is required, like we need police. We need a doctor. A simple example is given of how a doctor may tell a child, open your mouth, I want to look at your teeth. And the child opens the mouth and the the doctor looks at the teeth. And if a mother becomes too liberal, he says, oh, baby, would you like to open your teeth? He says, no, I won't. Would you like to open your mouth? No, I won't. And then, what becomes a 30-second exercise, the mother will have to spend 30 minutes to persuade the child. Open your mouth. So we can't have equality absolutely. It's not possible in the material world. So there is, from a functional perspective, the hierarchy is required. But we should not absolutize the hierarchy. That's why if there is adequate amount of spirituality, then adequate amount of spiritual understanding, then we will recognize the hierarchy as important. But we won't absolutize the hierarchy. We won't think that just because I am a teacher, that means I am better than others. Just because I am in a superior position, that means I am better than others. Just that in this particular position, I have to do a particular service. So the disciple is meant to offer respect to the spiritual master. But the spiritual master, we have Prabhupada telling the disciples that I consider you representatives of my spiritual master. So Prabhupada instructed them, but Prabhupada also respected them. So I think the whole issue of social justice comes when people feel disrespected. So it's not so much that people want equality in the sense that there's no hierarchy. If within a hierarchy somebody becomes disrespected and deprived, that is when the problem comes up. But if somebody is not disrespected and deprived, if they are appropriately respected, then the idea of hierarchy is not rejected by the principle of social justice. Thank you very much. I'll quickly summarize because we went a lot of places. So I spoke today on the topic of how the equality of Lord Shiva is not appreciated by Daksha because Daksha is envious of Lord Shiva. So generally we can detect envy within us when we feel unhappy on seeing others praised or glorified and try to pull them down from their position or try to laugh at them for where they are at. And the Lord's equality, the Lord's qualities are manifested in his devotees and in the devatas. So, for the purpose of establishing Siddhanta, we stress the bheda aspect, that everybody is not God. But in the in specific context, the abheda aspect may also be stressed. So here Prabhupada uses a verse that talks of Krishna's quality to describe the quality of, to illustrate the quality of Lord Shiva. So wherever, whatever is required for people to elevate themselves upwards, we do that. In pure devotional service, we do recognize that worship of devata is not required, but that does not mean worship of devata is demoniac. It is also appropriate for people at a particular level. Then I talked about how Krishna is partial, sorry, Krishna is impartial, but that is not stone-like neutrality. It is personal reciprocity. So Krishna, we can say, is partial to his devotees, but he opened the doors for devotion for everyone, and therefore he is impartially partial. God does not have favorites. God does not play favorites, but he does have favorites. And lastly, I talked about when we feel that there's partiality in the devotee community, it may well be just reciprocity. Somebody is taking up more responsibility and then they are given entrusted more facility because of that. And if sometimes circumstantially we are not getting particular facilities, rather than just harping on it, we can focus on the transit, that beyond the circumstantial is the transcendental. Krishna is watching and Krishna will reciprocate with our dedication, our devotion in due course. As he did with Prabhupada, who had practically no facilities for 40 years, and then he was blessed with extraordinary success in the last decade of his life. Thank you very much. Mantraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanande.